The word contains the meaning value chain analysis. Now, in this analysis, you view a business, you view a business as a chain of activities which are interlinked and interrelated with each other. For example, if I try to draw a chain, it's an imaginary chain. Some of you might be wearing a chain, right? Chain contains different links. They are interlinked and they are interdependent. Now, you have to view the business as a chain of activities. Means, you will divide the business into various activities which you carry out in an organization. This is the way of looking at the business. The way you have to look at the business is, what you do in the business, what activities you carry out in a business. Make a chain, make a list of all these activities which you carry out in your business. And on one activity, other activity is dependent. Let's take a simple example. In manufacturing industry, don't you think your sales and production activities are linked with each other? What to produce depends upon what will get sold. Naturally. Now your sales active means on sales production is dependent. Don't you think on production your material consumption is dependent? And on material consumption, material purchase is dependent. Don't you think purchase manager has to buy as much quantity of raw material as required by production department? And production department should produce the quantity which sales department can sell? Simple example I am giving. This was the common theme in budget topic, if you remember. On sales depends your production, on production depends raw material consumption, on raw material consumption depends raw material purchase and storage also. And on your production depends manpower requirement. Manpower is another resource required for production. Manpower function is handled by personnel department. To produce the goods, you need plant and machinery. For plant and machinery, you need capital investment. Of that capacity of plant and machinery you require. Capital budgeting goes in financial management field. A finance manager handles capital budgeting. Whether I should buy that machine or not, whether it is economically viable or not. We used to do the analysis using NPV. Capital expenditure decision to be taken. If you are experiencing that the demand for our product is very good, people are liking our product, but we are falling short of capacity to produce. You want to set up one more plant or a factory. It's a big decision to set up one more factory or not. For what? For that, whatever is the investment required. And from where that money will come in, how much will come through equity, how much will come through debt. It's a finance function. Don't you think all these are interlinked and interrelated? Each one is dependent on other. That is how the business is done. That is how a business is done. Now, so you have to make a list of all activities which you carry out in a business and form the link, because each activity is dependent on other activities. They are interrelated and interlinked. Once this is done, then what you have to do next in value chain analysis? First of all, it is a chain of activities. Organization is a chain of activities. Now you have to analyze each activity for the cost incurred on that activity and value added by that activity. I repeat, first you will make a list of activities carried out in your organization. Let us say activity A, B, C, D, E, F and so on. List of activities. Then cost incurred to carry out that activity and value which it adds in the chain of activities. We'll discuss step by step. This data you will obtain through activity-based costing. In activity-based costing topic, we maintain the cost record activity-wise. That is what the name is, activity-based costing. You have to maintain the cost record activity-wise, that on each activity, how much is the cost incurred. If you remember one word, or I have used that word, it is called cost pool. Means collecting the cost of each activity at one place is called activity cost pool. Is a technical word, don't worry. So from that record, your accounting record, you will come to know about the cost incurred on each activity. This data will be provided by your accounting system. If you are using activity based costing as an accounting tool, then you will get this data ready made from accounting system. Now we'll integrate that data with other data. Now try to understand. Each activity is carried out for benefit of someone. It means I am carrying out one activity, so someone should be the receiver or someone should be the beneficiary of that activity. Means someone is going to get benefited from that activity. That beneficiary is called your customer. That customer could be internal or that customer could be external. In this value chain analysis, we don't want to satisfy our customer's need, whether external or internal. For example, your stores department in the factory, stores department which stores raw material, what service that stores department provides to outside customer, tell me. No. Then who receives the service from stores department? For whom that department is existing in the factory? Raw material stores department. For production department? Stores department's responsibility is to supply proper quantity and quality of raw material to production department at proper time. Right time, right quantity, right quality. Only three things. Production manager's wish is that this department should supply me right quantity at right of right quality at right time when I would want. That's all. So who is the beneficiary of your services? Internally, your own department. It means your customer is one who receives the benefit from your activity. That customer could be internal, that customer could be external. Now, what you have to do? You first identify who is your customer, either internal or external, then talk to that customer that I am carrying out this activity for you. Are you receiving any benefit? Because value or benefit is the opinion of that customer who receives the benefit from your activity. We have discussed the word value. But here I am talking about value received by either internal or external customer. You ask your customer what benefit or value you are receiving. Based on the feedback of your customer, you have to derive the value. It is difficult to do it. It is difficult to convert it into monetary value. But still, if not possible in monetary value, at least make a note that whether customer is receiving value or not, at least make a note for that. In this process, what will happen? In this process, from customer's feedback, probably you will come to know that activity A is a value-added activity, let us say. Means customer values your service, whatever activity you carry out. Activity B is non-value-added. Activity C is value-added. Activity D is value-added. Activity E is non-value-added, and so on. This analysis you will do on the basis of feedback received from customers. Okay? Now, like I am delivering the lecture, it may add value to students who are in CA final. If your other friend from who is doing BCom, he comes and sits here, will it add any value to him? Probably no. So you have to ask your customer whether it adds any value to you or not. Once you do this analysis, then what next you can do? Those activities which are non-value added, you should stop these activities. Reason: you are carrying out that activity, you are incurring cost on that activity, but it is not delivering any benefit to the intended customer. Why you are doing it then? When your customer says, I don't get any value or benefit from your activity, then why the hell you are carrying out that activity? So you can drop non-value added activities. By doing this, what will happen? Some activities you will stop, the cost you will save, it will help you in reducing the cost. I think cost minimization is one of the objectives and value maximization is another objective. So by deleting non-value added activities, you will be able to achieve cost reduction. Point number one. Second, those activities which are value added, you will continue with those activities. But you have to continuously think. One word I told you to underline sometimes, continuous improvement. You have to keep on thinking continuously. can I carry out this activity in a better way? Means, can I deliver more value to the customer? And with changing circumstances, changing technology, changing situation, changing environment, you will find new ways of doing the same thing. And you can deliver more value to the customer. It is possible. So, you have to continuously keep thinking, can I add more value to the customer? But at a lower cost. By changing the way in which I do the business. Or with the change in the way by, through which I carry out a particular activity. This is a continuous process. You have to keep on thinking. When you do the analysis using these guidelines, you are doing value chain analysis. I'll take you to this point. A business is a chain of interdependent and interlinked activities. Each link in the chain adds some value, and finally you deliver a value to the external customer. This value received by external customer, this value gets accumulated over chain of activities which you carry out in an organization. You have to do the analysis of each of these activities, how much value each of these activities is adding in your value chain and at what cost, and keep continuously thinking how I can reduce the cost of carrying out that activity and how I can improve the value delivered from that activity. Anybody or any organization who is doing this on continuous basis is said to be following value chain analysis. Now tell me, if someone is doing this, don't you think that company will enjoy cost differentiation advantage? They will be doing the business at a lower cost, and product differentiation, that is value maximization advantage, because you are constantly thinking on two fronts: how to deliver better value at a lower cost, and in which internal organizations are also dependent. Please remember, if production department doesn't supply good quality goods to the sales department, how sales department can sell those goods? It means sometimes your activity may not directly affect the external customer. It will affect internal department. But you should satisfy needs and requirement of your internal department also. Because through this chain of activities, the final value gets created. And we commonly say, the strength of this chain, if you are judging the strength of this chain, the strength of this chain is always measured by its weakest link. Think over what I said. Imagine a physical chain. And you are pulling that chain, you are judging the strength of that chain. The chain will break from the weakest link. So, if this link in your organization is weak, you have to identify those weak links in your organization, because these weak links will affect your final value. So, you have to identify those weak links and improve there. Because due to few weak links, your value delivered to the customer may be getting affected. So, as I said, the strength of a chain is measured by its weakest link. Similarly, the strength of your organization or value delivered to the external customer is also affected by few weak links. You might be good at something, very good at something, but weak in some other things. So, you have to identify those weak areas and improve upon there, mend those weak links, so that you will be strengthening your entire chain over which the value gets delivered to the customer. Let's take an example of CA examination or CA course. It may happen that out of 8 papers, a student is scoring very good marks in 6 papers, very good marks, exemption in all 6 papers. But in 2 subjects, he is weak and unable to score 40. And unfortunately, one subject belongs to group 1 and one subject belongs to group 2, due to which the result of both the groups is affected. Don't you think this happens in our real life? In few subjects, very good marks, but one subject of group 1 and one subject of group 2, that is a hurdle, means that is the weak link. You have to pay attention there, because the moment you correct that, you are through. But this is the way you have to view, and this is the way organization is viewed, using value chain analysis. Is the word clear now? You have to analyze the value added by each activity in the chain of activities through which the value is delivered to the customer. Have I given you earlier the example of ATM machines? No. Let's take an example. Let's take one example. First of all, in value chain analysis, there are three objectives. I'll just orally say it must be written somewhere, I don't know. Three predominant objectives in value chain analysis. When you analyze each activity, how you will think? Your thinking pattern will be, can I reduce the cost of carrying out an activity? These both are important, cost and value. Because cost minimization and value maximization is the objective. For every activity, you will think, can I reduce the cost of carrying out that activity without affecting value received by customer? It means customer should receive same value, but I should operate that activity or carry out that activity at a lower cost. If it is possible, do it. Second view. Can I deliver more value to the customer at same cost? Are you getting my point? Means cost of carrying out the activity, let it be same, but can I try and deliver more value to the customer at same cost? That is second thinking. And third thinking or objective of value chain analysis is, can I achieve both simultaneously? It means, can I redesign my activity in such a manner that cost of carrying out that activity is also lower and value received by customer is also higher? It means you are achieving two objectives in one stroke. That is third way of thinking. And now let's take a practical example which is known to all of you. It means what I will talk will make some sense because you have experienced that. So I am taking an example of a banking sector. Banking sector, the way banks carry out their business. We'll take this simple example, giving services to your savings account holders, let us say. Your saving account holders, which is a large customer base of any bank who put their money in the savings account, and you want to provide them the services. What type of services an account holder requires? One time activity is opening the accounts, first time activity and one time only, by doing KYC compliance. ID proof, address proof, verified, and the customer's account is created. This is one time activity. After KYC procedure is completed and account is opened. Once that account is opened, throughout the lifetime, till the time that customer stays as your customer, what other services he want? He want to know the balance in the account. He want to deposit cash. He want to deposit check in the account. He want to withdraw the cash. Basically, and if he gives the check, the balance gets transferred to other person. These are the basic things or services which are required. Now, the way these services were given by banks in olden days, so I'll take you to our days, where all these services were provided through physical banking. Physical means you have to go to that bank only and that branch only where your account is located. We have done or we have worked in that environment. Still, people do that activity. Suppose if I have a savings account in SBI Tilak Road branch and I want to withdraw cash. I am talking about old days, go 20-25 years back. If I want to withdraw cash, I have to go to SBI only. Or can I go to ICICI Bank which is near to my house? No, because my account is not in ICICI Bank, my account is in SBI and that to Tilak Road branch. I have to go to Tilak Road branch only to withdraw my cash. And that too within banking hours. When bank is open, if bank is closed, naturally I cannot go. Bank is open generally in office time, which is your busy time also. And you want to withdraw the cash, you have to go to physically that bank and that branch to carry out the transaction. You want to give a checkbook request. You want to know or update my passbook. I have to visit the branch physically. This is the way banking services were given. And we have grown in the same era using these services. Now, with the advent of technology, banks change the style of doing the way. Change the style of carrying out same activity, providing same services to the customer but differently. And when these banks, they saw the way foreign banks are doing the business, they brought that concept to India and then came your ATM machines. Right. So from physical banking, I would say, physical banking at branch only, we shifted to use of ATM machines. We have seen the launching of these machines. because this transformation took place in front of our eyes. We have witnessed it. When first ATMs were introduced, by private sector banks, ICICI, HDFC, first these banks came out with ATM, not public sector banks. Public sector banks did it later. So ATM machines came up, looking at the way the banking operations are done in foreign countries, developed countries. Now, through ATM, you can give request of checkbook, you can see the balance, you can withdraw the cash, I think you can deposit the cash also, and there is a check drop box. It means almost all basic needs of a saving account holder are satisfied through ATM machine, so he doesn't have to come to the bank physically. Now see the convenience to the customer. I am talking about value received by customer. Huge convenience to the customer. Anytime, anywhere banking. If he gets time at 2 o'clock in the night, he can go at 2 o'clock and withdraw cash. He doesn't have to go in the office time. He can go to the nearest ATM and carry out the transaction. It means huge benefit or convenience to the customer, that is value received by customer very high. At the same time, bank's operating cost reduced drastically. Please remember, cost of operating a physical branch and cost of operating a ATM machine. Cost of operating an ATM machine is 1 by 20th of the cost of operating a physical branch. Physical branch means bigger premises, rent, electricity, employees, stationery, whatnot. And compared to that cost, see the cost of operating one ATM machine. How much space is required and how many employees are required there? Just use of technology. Use of technology, core banking, satellite connectivity of linking of all ATMs with each other. That is one time setup cost, structural cost we will say. But your operating cost got reduced substantially. It means in one stroke, what bank did? They reduced the cost of operation and they increased the value received by customer. Both things happened together in one stroke. This is what you have experienced. You might not have experienced this much. We have experienced this. In those days, we never complained because that was the only way. But today, looking at today's convenience, we feel that what way we used to carry out the banking operations. Now, earlier when ATM machines came into the field or in the picture, we could withdraw the cash from the ATM machine of the same bank in which you have an account. It means, if I have an account in SBI, I can withdraw cash only from SBI ATM. That was the restriction earlier. So what banks did? In order to provide good services to the customers, every bank tried to open ATM machines or ATM centers at different prominent places so that customers should find nearby place. There should be one ATM at least in a particular area. So there was a huge rush between all the banks to open ATM centers at variety of places. It means your capital expenditure went up of setting up of that machine, and then again operational cost. Then came a technological solution. Linking of ATMs. You know, today all ATM machines are linked with each other. Even if I am the customer of SBI, I can go and withdraw the cash from ICICI Bank. Or I can go and withdraw from HDFC Bank ATM, possible. Or I can go and withdraw from even Bank of Maharashtra, it's possible. It became possible through a software called NIFT, National Electronic Fund Transfer System, developed by RBI. First, RBI compelled all the banks to go to core banking solution, that is ERP software. RBI made it compulsory for all banks to migrate to core banking. Public sector banks were behind. They did not implement ERP, but then RBI gave the cutoff date. Once all banks came to the common platform of core banking, then RBI using NIFT software, which I know a little, right, National Electronic Fund Transfer System, they linked the softwares of all banks with each other. They integrated. That software of RBI integrated all core banking softwares of all the banks together. And the moment that was achieved, this facility was released. Today you can withdraw from any bank's ATM. If I am withdrawing cash from ICICI Bank's ATM, but I am a customer of SBI, suppose I have withdrawn 10,000. Due to this linking, what entry gets passed? See, whose cash has gone? ICICI bank's cash has gone, because ICICI bank fills the cash in that ATM. And which customer has taken? SBI customer has taken the cash. That software instantly passes an entry. In ICICI books, entry passed is SBI account debit to cash. ICICI bank shows receivable from State Bank, cash account credit, because their cash has gone. Same time, another entry is passed in the SBI's account. SBI passes the entry customer account debit. Debit means my balance will go down to ICICI bank, payable to ICICI. These entries are recorded instantly through that software. Now think what happened. Just this development came into place. See, the convenience received by customer has increased manifold now. A customer can obtain the same service from nearest ATM, whichever is nearest to his premises, his office or his residence. So you don't have to go and search for the ATM of the bank in which he has an account. Correct? So value received by customer has gone up. And I think bank's operational cost has gone down. Why? Now banks are not having a mad rush of opening ATM. Why? Everybody's ATM is my ATM now. If all banks together are having 50,000 ATMs, suppose in India, even my bank is giving services through 50,000 ATMs. So capital expenditure on setting up of ATM center and operational cost has further gone down, because your customer can access any ATM. So further reduction in cost, enhancement in value. Then another revolution came in. Internet banking. What all banks did? They created a portal, a website, secured website, through which they will give access to you, to a customer, and you can access their server, means your account, bank's server, you can access through your password. Correct? Now what happened? Even you don't have to go out of your house or office. Sitting on your table, from your laptop or computer system, you can do the transaction as per your convenience, even without going out of the house. Don't search for ATM also. So I think more value received by customer, more convenience to the customer, and customer is happy doing transactions through internet banking. Nowadays almost all taxes we pay through internet banking only. Now customer is receiving more convenience, and see what is happening in this process. Customer is happy, first of all, very happy. But customer is using his own premises, his own computer, his own electricity. He himself is entering the data, means manual work he is doing. He is taking the printout using his own stationery on his own printer. Still customer is happy. All cost shifted to customer. And all this cost shifted to customer, and bank's cost got reduced. Bank has to just maintain that website and server in a secured mode. That's all. That is the cost which bank has to incur. All costs got shifted to you, and still customer is happy. More value received by customer, lower operational cost to bank. And then we have already switched over to next phase of banking, that is mobile banking. It took a lot of time for RBI to give permission for mobile banking. We know that process, because banks were applying to RBI that please allow us to go for mobile banking, but RBI was thinking from all angle, from security angle and everything. And finally, when banks convinced the RBI that yes, you can carry out the transaction in a secured way through mobile, RBI gave the permission, and today it's an era of mobile banking. Sitting anywhere or just traveling, you can carry out your banking transaction today. So further convenience to customer, and again reduction in the operation cost of bank. I gave you this example because you can correlate, you have seen this. This is the way we think in value chain analysis. Think over what activities you carry out. What is the cost at which you are carrying out that activity? And what is the value received by customer? And can you do the same thing at a lower cost and deliver more value? Keep doing this analysis on continuous basis, and you will keep finding the solutions, and you will keep improving. And therefore, banks' margins are going up because cost is going down. If banks are able to manage their loan accounts properly, NPAs, bank can make huge amount of money. Because this is on deposit side. Deposit side operational cost has gone down drastically. But loan side, if properly managed and if banks are able to manage their NPA accounts properly, if they don't allow the borrower to turn into NPA, banks can make huge amount of money. This is in front of you. And I expect in future what will happen. See, when first time ATM machines came, don't get surprised. Huh? We have seen such scenes that people staring that cash is coming out of the machine because there's a glass door. And people outside used to watch that cash is coming out of that machine. So they used to come and inquire with that watchman. Earlier there used to be watchman at the gate. That I also want some cash from this machine. I'm talking about initial phases. Initial phases when ATMs were not very common. And people saw machine dispensing out cash. So everybody was delighted that there is a machine available. Like water dispenser is there. Coffee dispenser is there. There's a cash dispenser. Where some people go, they stand and cash comes out. Don't be surprised when I had told this to one of my aunt that this is a facility available. She said, give me also one card. I can also go and withdraw as per my wish. I said, first you have to deposit money there in the account, then only it comes out of the machine. She said, okay, it is like that. I said, yes. It's a real life story which I am telling. One of my aunt said that provide me this card also. I will also withdraw as per my convenience. But I said first you have to deposit, then it comes. But that were the reaction in the initial phases. Nobody had imagined from this to this when people shifted over that this can work and this can work flawlessly. People didn't have the trust on those machines earlier. I am talking about initial phases. How people will trust? Because they are habituated of doing banking through this procedure for years together. So it was very difficult for people to switch over initially. And from that we have reached up to this today. And who knows in future? I am just talking about future. Right? And you are going to experience all this. Who knows in future with the invent of artificial intelligence is coming into place now. Lot of people, technological people are working on AI, artificial intelligence. Your CPU, this one, may get linked with bank's server. Who knows, bank server will recognize this CPU and that CPU has to link in a secured manner. And sitting here in the classroom, you thought, oh, that client's tax was to be paid, 10,000 rupees direct tax. The message got transmitted to the server, payment is done. Now it sounds funny, no? Because I am talking about future. When we would have said this 20 years before that a cash can come out from machine, people laugh the same way. That's what I'm saying. This is okay. It's only change of time. People got accustomed to this. Who knows tomorrow this will happen? Or you just give a voice message, the machine recognizes your voice command and transaction is executed. Even you don't have to punch. Voice recognition is already in place at few places, not financial transaction, but tomorrow it may happen. That pay 10,000 to this, 15,000 to this, pay salary to all the employees. Salary payment is done. Who knows? Who knows? We have to experience that in time to come. This continuous innovation gets triggered when you start thinking on these lines. Value chain analysis. Therefore, I said the topic is very interesting and it will have impact on all chapters. Because every chapter, this is the line of thinking. How can I do the business at a lower cost and deliver highest value to the customer? But for that, you have to analyze each and every activity which you carry out in the organization and find the scope for improvement. Wherever possible, try to find out the scope for improvement in such a huge chain of activities. You'll find so many places where you can improve upon. Are you getting it? You might be good in one, but bad in other activity. Try and identify. And this is the way to stay ahead of your competition and then gain the strategic position in the market, and you will be ahead of the competitors. What I am talking about business, because in our syllabus it is for business activity, all this is applicable to individuals as well. We all as individuals can think on these lines for ourselves as well as for our businesses.